My name is Kalle Lytinen. I am the from Case Western Reserve University. I'm from the Design and Innovation Department, currently the chair of the department. And I'm also worked on this area of digital innovation at least 35 years of my academic life in different roles, looking at things like mobile business, CAD-CAM design, digital design in industrial settings, software engineering requirements, you name it. And we have a very talented and good panel. We are going to discuss the challenges which this transformation sets up for the type of talent you need in order to execute on digital transformation and innovate with digital technologies. We have actually both this hot and cool side of it, so to speak. We have Pavan K. Divarla from Progressive. He is the head of the, and I'm going to do more detailed introductions from Progressive, mostly in the sort of big data and data science side, and Bill Nottingham, which many of you know, from Nottingham Spurk, and he's on the sort of design thinking and product innovation space. So, let's see how it works. Just a few observations. Why are we actually in this space, and why do we discuss that? We could, in a way, go 100 years back and think about the situation around 1870, 1875, when the Industrial Revolution happened in this setting, in and the sort of Rockefeller and others, and started the oil combustion business issues. And you can think what sort of talent you had to bring into the in order to establish corporate industrial organization, and how you have to establish the functional talent, but how you also have to introduce talent to innovate on technologies and do that on scale. In a way, we are in a similar type of situation currently if you look at the sort of broad picture. It is a question of a new type of industrial change and revolution which underlies the use of the digital technologies and digital capabilities. And at the end, it's a question of that you assimilate these technologies in the firm operations, which changes its activity scope and boundaries and goals. And the hardest part in that is, of course, to prepare the organization to build competencies to do that. And that cuts across changing how it acts in different settings, the activities, how it thinks about the environment, and how it feels about itself. What is the identity of that company? Is it an industrial company? Is it a manufacturing company? Or is it some type of other type of company? These are the things which actually many of the companies which are dealing with digital technologies and this transformation are struggling with. And we know also that it's much harder, and that's why we are having this conference, for established incumbents, for many of them which may have started in 1870s in this area, or in somewhere in Midwest and even broader, and now they have to sort of start competing in many situations with companies which are born digital. They have organizational inertia investments, which may not be any more valuable, and they have cognitive inertia. They have learned to think in certain ways about their environments and their sort of businesses and other things. And in order to overcome that, the only way you do that is you have to somehow involve in talent development, which is basically learning, but also unlearning. You have to learn to give up certain things, which is much harder. And we know also that this will not happen over time. It needs to be balanced and contextualized. So we know that what has to be done, who does it, why we need to do it, and at what stage we have to do it, and how do we do it. We have to also understand what needs to be internalized and what needs to be externalized. There is currently in certain fields, the idea of corporate inversion. If you look at certain companies, especially born digital companies, pure companies like digital, like Google, Facebook, and so forth, and you compare their cap value with the number of people they employ, most of the stuff actually is carried in those companies by outsiders, not the companies themselves. So what is the core and what is the external, and how we build this relationship is very different than in the past, which has to be also learned in this situation. So what we are going to look at here a little bit is that there are different levels. So what type of individuals and employees you need, how they have to change, which you currently have, and how do you actually expand that, those individuals? How do we orchestrate talent in teams for innovation and digital transformation? and we will have people here talking about it. And what are the critical competency areas at the firm level, which my company needs to have, and how they will change in the next 5 to 10 years. We have to also understand that timing and velocity matters. It may be so that in certain points of time you have to do it very fast, and that can be painful. The other one is that you have to understand is that you have to, what they call the exploration, you have to increase the variance of the types of knowledge we have to deal with when you start working in digital space. And we have learned something about that already. So these are the specific issues which we are going to discuss. How do you train designers and analytics people with the design when you innovate in this situation? How do we want one person to have both skills, or do we distribute them? How do we acquire new talents and retrain old talents? And what other competencies might be important in these settings? And what are some challenges currently in developing this type of talent in this setting? We, of course, from the university are very interested in, because we are basically producing talent, and we want to know what type of talent this area environment needs. And also we want to understand how to help the companies to build their talent over time in these settings. So what is the agenda? I've been to sort of doing the short introduction, and we have two people here speaking. The first one who is going to speak about 15 minutes is Pavan K. Divakarla. He joined the Progressive at 2004. He's been there 15 years. And he's worked on direct consumer acquisition systems, on building architecture roadmaps and new user experience for future customer acquisition systems. And he also led big data efforts at Progressive, which includes execution, business use cases, and infrastructure and capability build-out. So he's pretty much in the over the whole space on how you actually integrate big data type of talent into established company and environment, which of course is largely in the business of understanding information and using that for business cases. And the other speaker after that is going to be Bill Nottingham, which many of you may already know. He comes from Nottingham Spurk, and he's going to talk about the design thinking talent and how you leverage that, in especially in the design teams and other settings. Many of you may know already Bill, but he comes from Nottingham Spurk, which is one of the leading, where he's leading both the business development and marketing initiatives of the firm. And he's a member of the Nottingham Spurk leadership team. And he focuses on the future growth and sustainability of the firm. And Nottingham Spurk is a business innovation firm which has been around since 1972, and it has been one of the leading actors in that space for that period of time. And its work has resulted to over 1,250 different patents in different products where they have participated as part of the product development teams. I'm not going to go through all the accolades I can give for Bill, but you can see that we have a real expert here on this topic. So the way in which we are going to do it is that both of them will talk about 15 minutes. You may do some short clarifying questions at that time, and then we will have a sort of between team discussion, maybe 5 to 10 minutes if there are some comments which others want to make, and then we'll start asking questions from the floor for about 45 minutes. And I try to do this as interactive as possible. I try to organize it in a way that we start first from the individual level, and then sort of team orchestration, and lastly at the firm level talent development, so that we have some sort of saga which we build up over time on this. And welcome once again, and Pavan is the next one. Welcome.
Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. Thank you for the invitation. It's nice to see some familiar faces in here. I grew up in a university setting back in India, and so every chance I get to come out and be in front of a university setting is sort of really like feels like home to me. So thank you for inviting me home. So thank you. So this is a great topic. We have lots of thoughts on it. I'll get into a few of the questions that were brought up earlier, but we'll probably go through more questions during Q&A, because the topic is somewhat complex and evolving, so it's not like we have the answers. And it's kind of depends on how we want to set up at Progressive the future and so on. So let's get started. So as it was introduced, my name is Pavan Divakarla. The W gets a lot of people confused. It's actually more like a V, so it's P plus oven. So if you remember oven, put a P, Pavan. And I've been with Progressive for 15 years. And truth be told, I didn't quite think I'd be here 15 years, but it's an amazing company. And I have some amazing colleagues to work with. And we have some really interesting problems to work on. And so when you put those two together, makes for a great place to work. So I've definitely enjoyed my 15 years and looking forward to more. We are in Mayfield Village. I think some of you know this. It's about 24 minutes to get there from here, and so it's not that bad. And we actually have a campus. So if you were to come on an evening and fly a drone, you'll see something like this. It's quite beautiful, you know. And this is sort of a key piece of you know, as we look into the future, some of the digital native companies like your Googles and Facebooks of the world, they actually look like this, right? It's the work environment is almost as important as the work itself. And so this used to be an old golf course that we put a whole bunch of buildings on top. And so we have buildings that are called bunker, fairways, greens, trees, woods. We have a sand wedge, we have a clubhouse, we have a prog shop, and so on. So everything is golf themed. And we have workout facilities and all that stuff. And again, very important to have. And if you were to kind of take a quick sort of walk inside Progressive, you'll probably experience something like this.
Happiness hit the like a train on a track. Coming towards her, stuck still, no turning back. She hid around corners and she hid under beds. She killed it with kisses.
So that's just a quick 50-second trip inside Progressive. We have, like I was saying, fitness centers and innovation place and, you know, farmers market, you name it. And again, a key piece of how you retain talent is you gotta like just go beyond what we would think as a classic company. So if you go to progressive.com, you'd probably see something like this. And we sell a whole bunch of products. I mean, we're known for auto insurance, but we also sell motorcycle, boat, RVs, Segway, so on, so on, so on. And we're sort of getting into a portfolio of products, just like how, say, Amazon was. You know, they started with books, and now they have a portfolio of products to sell. And all of these are basically driven by data, right? So we're not making phones or tables or chairs. We basically use a lot of data to produce more data. And so our product really is data. And so a lot of people sometimes call me and say, hey, do you want to work on an information product? And I'm like, insurance is an insurance, is an information product. So that's the way we think about it. So data is sort of core at what we do. In a different presentation of mine, I have something like it says air, water, data. It's like right up there. Because it's if you really were to take a vacuum cleaner and take all the data out of Progressive, we may not have many things to work on. So it's sort of really crucial. And one thing that sort of brings us all together is we have these things called the core values. And you know, it's not something that's just on a website or on a web page. Literally, I can tell you every meeting, every interaction has these pieces to it: integrity, golden rule, objectives, excellence, and profit. That's sort of how we do things. And culture really is core to what we do. We just had our Gallup survey, which goes to the entire 40,000 employees. We look at the scores, we look at the comments, we work on it, we look for things people like and continue to do those. We look for things that folks want to change and we work on those. So very, very active. And it's a great place to work. We've gotten some few awards recently, and we really want this to be a key piece. So getting into the piece here is The way we think about digital transformation is the following. So the way we think about Progressive is today we have what we call the Horizon Strategy, which is Horizon 1 is we're executing on things we know we need to do, right? Auto insurance, motorcycle, boat, et cetera. And then we think of something called Horizon 2, which is expand, like how do we get into other products? Think of like commercial lines and business owner products and things like that. And then whatever the future will hold is in Horizon 3. So this is where we experiment on things that we don't know what's going to happen, right? You know, if self-driving cars come in, what is the future of insurance? You know, if are there other products we should be thinking about? Are there sensors we should be insuring? You know, there's like a whole range of things that we need to be thinking about. And so it's sort of more of a layered cake in terms of how we think about our revenue. We sort of have our bread and butter, we have some sort of icing on the cake, and then future stuff. And digital transformation is going to cut across all of this stuff for us, right? And so that's the key piece here. And so when we hear the word digital transformation, and the speaker earlier had said, you know, the transformation is like with a capital T. It's not just another transformation. It's truly, truly different. And what it gives to a company like us is it gives a lot of disruption, right? It's not like, oh, we're just going to start another transformation effort. It's truly, truly disruptive. And which means every notion that we had is going to get challenged. Everything that we have is going to be turned upside down. And it's better to know that ahead of time than to be surprised by it later, right? And so we're constantly thinking of these technologies or these processes or this business way of doing things is going to be disruptive. And so the intersection will be of tools, technologies, people, and process, right? These all have to sort of interplay with each other, and it's just not one or the other. So we can fix the people issue, but if we don't have the right tools, you're back at the same problem. You may have an awesome set of toolkit, but if you don't have the right people, you're at the problem. If you don't have a good business problem, you're back to square one. So these have to all like interplay with each other. So I'm gonna kind of walk you through a few things of how we're rethinking, and more related to the talent side, because that's the topic of today, but I could do the same rethink as it relates to technology or rethink as it relates to business process. So first one is Dr. Yu's example, which I really, really liked, is, you know, if you were to rethink the product and do this, that's not what we're talking about, right? Because this is just like if you take a web page and put make it smaller and put it on a mobile phone, well, that's not digital, right? And so if you take Dr. Yu's class, you know, he talks about doing something like this. This is truly transformative. And when people look at this example, they'll be like, oh yeah, this is different. You know, it knows when you leave home, it knows when you leave work. It's not just another thermostat, it's different. So we need to think, like as insurance specialists, we need to think about our product. Like what are we actually putting out in the market and what kind of people do we need to help us rethink this? So we need to rethink silos and roles, right? So today we're structured a certain way, lots of business units, you know, groups, et cetera, et cetera. And so we have all these titles, right? And generally they're all like in one, you know, each horizontal row may be on a certain team, but that's not how we're gonna structure our teams, right? We may now have teams that look like this, cross-functional. You know, you may have a team with a data scientist and a cloud engineer and a DevOps engineer and a project manager. There's like all these cross-functional teams. Each of these people actually have different managers. They're in different business units. They have different objectives, different performance evaluations. But how do you construct a team like this? Because to get digital transformation, you need a team like this or a team like that. Again, very different organizations, but they all have to come together towards a common goal. So that's rethink number one. The second one is we need to rethink just not having more quants. You know, it's not about just having a whole bunch of actuary folks and mathematicians. Now you need these cross-functional teams. So sort of investing in diversity of thought and just sort of making diversity more deliberate is sort of another key component of how we think about the future. I was at a McKinsey conference recently and they talked about these sort of teams that bring different roles together. So here's some examples. There's a business person, a translator, a data engineering person. It's like just the one I explained earlier. Some of our leadership styles have to change, right? We just can't be, you know, sort of the yang way of doing things. We have to bring a little bit more of yin into our leadership. And again, this is something we are thinking about actively, because we have to now think differently and work with our employees differently. Because if you hire some new people and you have more of a yang leadership, they'll probably leave. Right? You know, one of the most common reasons people leave is because they don't have the right manager or they don't have the right environment. It's not about them, it becomes about the people. We should rethink university partnerships, you know. So probably Bill and I are here because we think that there's a lot of talent at the universities, and maybe the old way of, you know, just getting an intern and then the intern goes back, maybe that's not the way to do this. Maybe we need to come teach more. You need to come teach us more. Maybe we need to have students more going back and forth. I always think of, like, can we have like a tunnel between, you know, Case and Progressive, for example, right? And you know, like Google and Stanford, they seem to have something going, because it feels like there's just this, if you were to just go do a YouTube search on some of the classes that are taught, it sort of goes back and forth. And sometimes you don't know who's who, and that's what we need. So I think we need to rethink university relationships. We need to rethink the setup. Like, if you get the right people, but you make them sit in these cubes, that's not going to work, right? And so now we have workspaces that somewhat look like this, sort of like what's downstairs where Mark Griswold works, I think looks very similar to this, right? We need to rethink this. And so our real estate group needs to get involved in, like, what is it? And people want to touch the data. People may want to experiment, et cetera. So we have a lot of workspaces. This, you know, managers don't have offices as much anymore, because what are you going to do in your office? You need to be out, and you need to be working with the team. We need to rethink how we think of MVP. You know, this is how we go to market. And normally, this is how we would think of an MVP. It's, you know, start by the tire, the this, the that, and you build this car, and this takes a long time. And you come out with a car, and no one wants to buy this car anymore, because it's not what was you wanted to do. So we're sort of rethinking MVP to maybe look something like this, which is like, you know, maybe we need to go out to the market and try some of these things, you know. Could be in beta, could be in alpha, et cetera. And again, how do you get the team to think this way, right? Because how do you test in this world? How do you market in this world? How do you make ads in this world? It's a very different world to think about. But again, a lot of rethinking has to happen. One of the other skills we need to be thinking about is curiosity. And again, we're not sure how to inculcate this, but if you create the right environment, people have to ask the question, right? And so often we'll ask a question at work and someone will say, well, that's not the right question to ask. This is the right question to ask. And that's the kind of things we look for, is how do we have more curiosity, more open door, where people are actually asking these questions. We need to rethink the work, right? And if you, again, have more of a waterfall approach where you say, this is the problem, I'll see you, you know, 3 years from now, that's not going to work again. And so we have more of like scrum teams and so on, fast iteration, 2 week sprint cycles. You're somewhat sure where you're going, like somewhere in Florida, but you're not sure exactly where, but you just start driving, you know? And you'll get there, and you'll probably get there to the right place with a better product. So that's something we're thinking about a lot. And so lots of scrum teams. And so how does a project manager work in this setup? Again, something to rethink. It's like, well, it's no longer a project. How do you test in this space? Lots to rethink. Somewhere along the line, you know, and Bill may sort of have a thought on this, is we sometimes end up forgetting the user. Like, why are we building this product? You know, yes, we want to be profitable and we want to grow, but it's all about the user. And so we sometimes forget the user. So we're trying to bring back the user in this discussion, because if you do a digital transformation and you don't bring back the user, you're going to end up with something that's not going to be ideal. So a lot of thinking around bringing back the user. And how do you, again, have the talent internally to say, yeah, we need to go and actually talk to some customers and think about this. We need to experiment more. So we have this thing called the Business Innovation Garage, where no idea is a bad idea. You can walk in, as you can see, the doors are open. You walk in and you say, I have this idea. I want to really try it. And normally in your day jobs, it's hard to experiment, but we're trying to do more of this for our engineers and staff so they can actually go and try this. So experimentation and opening these doors, I think, is key. And having, again, the right people who are like the owners of the garage to allow these people to come in and so on. So we have these garage mechanics, again, who will take in anybody, and they're not going to be judgmental about the idea. They're going to say, yeah, let's talk about it. have just a couple more. We need to rethink training. I know that was one of the questions earlier. In, you know, classroom training doesn't work. One thing that's worked really well for us is we do a lot of hackathons internally. And yes, we're trying a new idea, but one of the things sort of that comes out of a hackathon is people get trained on things that normally they won't have. They get access to data that normally they won't have, right? And so it's amazing that how just even a 24-hour hackathon suddenly upskills people very nicely. And then finally, we need to think about how we source our candidates. You know, it's no longer, you know, put a thing out on LinkedIn or put a thing out on, you know, Glassdoor. We've got to do a lot of social media work. We got to do a lot of various sort of activities to bring the user in. Because how do people know what's behind the walls at Progressive until we do presentations like this or other presentations where we actually open up our doors? So I speak a lot. A lot of my colleagues go out and speak a lot about sort of demystifying insurance, demystifying Progressive. You know, what are we on the inside is what counts, right? So again, a lot of time is spent in sort of rethinking some of this. And once we have all of these sort of pieces and parts in place, we tend to get very nice staff. They are thinking about the future. They are future leaders of our companies, and that's how we think. So just to give you a glimpse of how we're thinking about talent at Progressive. Thank you.
Well, thank you. Fascinating. I can't wait to interact with you a little bit more so we could talk about some of the things you're explaining. Bill Nottingham, Nottingham Spurk. I put a little presentation together here, and this first video gives you a little background on who we are as a company.
People. When everyone comes together, it creates this real explosion of creativity.
Sometimes the solution isn't right in front of you. And somebody said, well, we could, but what if, and then all of a sudden, we've got a path to making something from absolutely nothing.
There's very few companies in the world that can do what we do.
We do the front end to the back end of innovation. We help create the concepts, we create the prototypes, and then we translate it to production, and we commercialize.
We have the staff, the team, facilities to create almost anything.
Our power is being together in one building.
There's no other company that has all of those disciplines under one roof that can produce and then get to market in the time that we can. You can't replicate that.
We've got a focus group facility on site. We also do quantitative research.
We have marketing, design.
You could be looking at, you know, garden hoses to get ideas for surgical devices.
The engineers and the industrial designers work hand in hand from start to finish on a project.
In engineering and prototyping, we have the most amazing sculptors, craftsmen.
3D printers, and we are literally vertically integrated.
We all bring to the table something different. We appreciate that in each other.
You want to make an impact for yourself, for your client, for the sake of design. Every single one of us is driven from the minute we start a project to make sure it succeeds.
You have to listen to your customer. I mean, we could fall in love with a lot of things, but you have to listen.
All we've ever done is innovate. It's about creating something that makes a difference and that people value.
So I thought I'd kind of talk a little bit about some of the team structure that is some of what Pavan was talking about. Is, you know, typical companies have this hierarchy where people are more focused on where the idea came from, what the translation is from an idea to a final solution. And what we've found in our business is this almost creating micro teams. So, you know, you have, you know, lots of different thinkers involved in every engagement. So everyone has skin in the game throughout the process. And what happens is when you create these micro teams that have ownership, you're more flexible in evolving through, say, a digital transformation type of engagement versus a non. And so it's almost like creating micro startups through the process. And there's an interesting case study I want to talk about, which is a concept called the Marvel Method. And back in the 60s, when Stan Lee was developing tons of comics, they would start out the process by having writers dictating to the artists what they would be making. And they just couldn't keep up with demand. And so he really transformed the process by saying, you know what, I'm going to give the designers a chance to create comics. And what happened was this explosion of creativity where comics became more of a digital medium, or more of a creative medium, or more of a visual medium. And so what that says is, you know, there's no one way to do it. You've got, if you have one type of individual, you have another, they all come up from a different perspective. And so, you know, part of the thing, this digital transformation is, you've got these design thinkers, you've got these analytical thinkers, you've got digital processes, you've got manual processes. Well, all of those are important. And I think the core is, you want to be able to enable each type of individual to have the ability to lead and transform the company. You know, it's really all about balanced teams. And so it's really the design thinking and the analytical. At NS, we've actually employed quite a wide variety of individuals. We call our process vertical innovation. And the goal is, you know, at every step of the process, the whole team is involved. There's no such thing as a horizontal handoffs, as I call it. You know, when you look at developing a product or developing a solution, it takes proper insights. It takes user experience when there's a digital interface. It takes design, it takes engineering, it takes prototyping, it takes manufacturing, and they all need to be involved in every step of the process. So like I said, it's almost like creating a startup where you need to have all the tools on staff at every single part of the process. And when you look at it, I point out there's a couple different levels. So you got the analyticals and the design. And each one is important. Each one is involved, and each one has skin all the way through. Now, if your company really wants to have this digital transformation, you've got to be open to outside influences. It just doesn't have to do with inside of your company. And you were talking about this as well. He was talking about educational partnerships. Well, you know, here's the thing. Get out of the office. See what's going on. See what's in the market. There's two great events that I like to go to that really gets me into the feeling of what's going on in the technology perspective. I call it South by Southwest. I call the front end of innovation, and the Consumer Electronics Show I call the back end of innovation. These two are really complementary because if you go to South by Southwest in the interactive portion, you'll see lots of MVPs. You see lots of things in the works that aren't quite finished yet. And then if you go to CES, everything's ready to go. Everything's ready to launch. Both are very complementary and both are important. Everybody here that's in a company should think about how they play in each of these types of events. If you're not involved in CES, figure it out, because that is one of the most exciting places to be when it comes to technology. Everybody here is a technology company. You got to get over it. Everybody here is. So how would you play in these categories? Go check it out. Experiment. What I found interesting enough was going at South by Southwest. Let me give a little insight of what CES is.
My feet can't touch the ground, and it feels like I can see the sands on the horizon at time.
You know, and what's so exciting about CES is it's one of the biggest shows in the world, and you see quite a wide variety. And even if it doesn't make sense to your company, you will come away with a couple ideas that you could bring back home. It's about being inspired and opening yourself up. If you're not in the digital space, go there. Trust me, you will come back with a ton of ideas, a ton of examples of what to do. One of the companies I'd like to talk about today was two combinations of companies that had really, ironically enough, don't seem like they would make sense. But when you look at, there's a project that you may have seen being marketed right now called Project Jacquard. And it's an example of Levi's, a very a classic American company known in the material space, and then Google, which is completely technology focused. These two companies came together and created a project called Project Jacquard. And what's interesting is, you know, you look at Levi's. How would they get into the technology space? How would they have the right? Well, think about it. Could it be, you know, we talk about these wearables. Well, I always say the new wearable is what you're already wearing. You know, in Google, they're not an apparel company, so it's a great mix. So if you're a company that may not feel technology focused, a quick way to do it is to get with a company that is. Now all of a sudden, you're playing together and you're learning how to do this, and then you can do it on your own. It's like almost like training wheels, but at the same time, you both benefit each other. I'll tell you a little bit about this technology. Jacquard is a classic machine that was invented simply the process of manufacturing denim. And so they took this analogy of a Jacquard machine and technology, and they made that a whole new concept. Interweaving some of the wiring and whatnot inside the denim, and what happens is the denim becomes the controller.
There's 15 Jacquard threads woven into the jackets right here.
Okay.
We're going to go through the app right now. We're going to go through the hanger, Jacquard threads, and we're going to press it. So it feels a motion, and it's going to show you on the interface of the app. It's also pressure sensitive as well.
So it might be a little hard to hear, but essentially what happens is you've got this app and you've got the controller embedded within the denim itself, and there's a Google kind of a device that's clipped to the sleeve with a battery, and literally by taking your hands across the sleeve, it controls the sound and other types of features within the Google app.
It is 12:08 p.m.
I also changed it so that...
So really the take-home message is collaboration. Open innovation. I believe it's essential for companies to truly digitally evolve and also to get in the game sooner. And I'll give you one last example. Club car. The golf cart was invented in the 1950s and hasn't really changed for over 50 years. You know, you could arguably say they are not a technology company. But, you know, think about it. Technology, we actually came to them with an open innovation that brought them into the technology space and brought them to CES. And technology was able to get them into the fitness space, believe it or not. And so what we did is we actually piloted a product called the Rover a caddy. I call it the first truly commercialized autonomous vehicle. So essentially you're wearing a transmitter on your belt and it follows you within a 3-foot distance. You know, it's funny, everybody says that golf is a fitness sport, but how is it fitness if you're sitting in a car, eating and drinking? It's a very freeing experience. Now, the key here is we needed to pilot it ourselves. It took us several years to perfect the process. We aligned with a couple of golf courses in South Carolina, and once it was proven, we showed it to Club Car. They liked the idea. And we exhibited at the Consumer Electronics Show.
There are more than 4,000 companies that showed up, the latest and greatest.
And almost instantly, they became a tech company.
Today, contributor
and now when they start taking ownership, it takes on, and they take full ownership of this device, it's going to transform their entire business.
So if you find yourself wanting to get a few rounds of golf this summer, you have a little companion coming along with. Well, it's been a long day. I think I'm going to get a few holes in before sunset. Let's go, buddy.
And then last but not least, this is now the Club Car product.
There's a new way to play golf that combines fitness and fun for a one-of-a-kind
experience. You can kind of see the transition of how we started with them to develop.
Introducing Tempo Walk, a hands-free caddy that follows golfers while they walk, talk, play, and enjoy the nature of golf. Find out how to bring Tempo Walk to your course at.
So really, you know, the thought is, you know, what good is an innovation if it's just stuck inside of your walls? It's like a tree falling in the woods. Does anybody care if they haven't heard it? I think the most important factor is companies need to be open to ideas outside of their organization, along with people individually being open to other people's perspectives as well. And when you start to build your team, it isn't necessarily about transferring the talent you already have. It's about bringing a diversity within your team and then a diversity outside of your team to make that true transformation, because we don't have time to wait. You know, if you want to immediately get involved in the game of the digital space, you got to collaborate. And so that's my thought today. Sure.
We have heard a lot of good ideas. I don't know whether the gentleman here want to comment on things which were raised. I'll just make three short observations in general, what we heard. And I think the first one is that the digital transformation comes with the potential of the idea that what are we going to do when we can design pretty much anything. So as a result of that, this idea of design thinking has become much more important, how you are sort of empathetic, how you understand user needs and other things, because if you can design pretty much anything, what matters is that you get it right. The second aspect, which I the issue is not about what type of talent or what types of skills you use to produce a certain type of product. It is largely about getting the process right and the orchestration of the talent right for those processes. So it's like a second level talent level at the organization. And that comes from also the fact that the digital technology innovation is very fluid. So you cannot fix it. It will be evolving all the time. And it is heterogeneous in the sense that you don't necessarily know what type of knowledge you need in order to be really successful. I think Bill's point about finding and going outside is a good example of that. But there are a lot of different ways of doing that. And the second point which I want to make is that the sort of the speed and the if you start thinking about the talent in a sort of traditional a pretty static and functional way that I need X amount of certain types of engineers and Y amount of the other types of engineers, and in order to get this thing, fixed product done, you are probably bound to fail. You have to probably start thinking about a talent development more like an ongoing process in which you engage in things and you build your talent as you move along. It's more like building a ship when you are sailing all the time. And you don't necessarily know exactly where the ship is going to go because the environment is turbulent and the sort of innovation speed is so high. So it's a very different type of environment to think about the talent and the skills than used to be maybe in the traditional corporate industrial organization world where the timelines were different and the markets and products were relatively fixed. So I think that those are the sort of key points which I could sort of synthesize from these presentations. But I'd like to hear from, if you want to comment on in any way what the other one said, and then we can move to the questions from the floor.
Yeah, I think we should take questions. Yeah.
Alex Pessoa from John Deere. Pavan, you mentioned the importance and relevance of getting this thought diversity. How does Progressive manage thought diversity?
Sure. I think I have it. Thought diversity. So yeah, that's a, how do we manage it? A couple different ways. So first of all, when we are hiring, you know, that we have a certain way we are, maybe there was a certain way we used to hire, right? And now we're looking at other skills when we hire, right? So used to be where you would say, you know, how good are you at, I don't know, let's say advanced analytics and machine learning or something like that. Now we're saying, how good are you at those? But also show us examples of working in a team and how have you thought of a problem maybe differently, right? Where someone said, well, I think we're going to march this way. And they said, no, I think the answer should become, it's more like orthogonal thinking. And so we now are creating places where we are allowing people to have this orthogonal thinking thought, right? And so if they say, well, I think maybe the actual answer is this and not this, or maybe we should approach the problem this way or that way, we're sort of, we have to overly encourage that and not like shut it down. So we have the innovation garage where people can come and kind of exhibit some of that, right? We have coaching for the managers to encourage that to come in. So they're not like shutting it down, saying, well, that's not the way, you know, that's not the way we do it. So, you know, one of the most common questions is, answers you'll get is when you have a different kind of thought is, well, we've always done it this way. And I think when someone says that in the room, they're somewhat in the minority, and it's almost like the wrong thing to say nowadays. It's like, you know, you don't say that anymore. Maybe it used to work, you know, in a different setting, and that's fine. And so the other sort of way we're sort of thinking of this is sometimes when you have something like digital transformation, you may think what you have is broken. And it's really not broken. I think what was designed for a different era, right? And so, because what happens is, because we have people with long tenures and people, you know, are there. So if you tell the person who built the table that the table is broken, you know, he may not or she may not be very happy about it. But if the table was designed for, you know, the 1970s and we're in the 2010s, well, that's a different story, right? So
I think you make a good point. You know, it's like, it is about the talent. It is about the diversity of thought, because it's not like a company that used to do chairs in the 70s couldn't be doing digital chairs now.
Correct.
It all starts with creativity. When we do the hiring, we look for people saying the words we instead of I. Mm-hmm. When someone uses the word I way too much during an interview, you clearly start to see that they are not open to ideas. And I think that, you know, I know you were showing your environment being more of an open space where they're interacting with others more often. You're getting comfortable with each other.
Yep.
You're not worried about this person saying something over me or this perspective being more important. Because if you're comfortable with each other, there's a free flow of ideas.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so now it becomes this collaborative spirit instead of an ownership spirit, right?
Yeah. We have tools like GitHub and so on where actually it by nature allows people to put in comments. We have this thing called Edison where you can put in ideas and people can thumb it up and down. So we have lots of different places where it's okay to have a, you know, different thought, and you'll be recognized for it. And maybe it's the idea is too good is good, but for a later time. So we have, instead of saying no, we say a lot more like not now or maybe in a different setting. So sort of we're sort of pivoting into not squishing a different way of thinking, and then you end up with all this sort of ideas come through, and then the problem becomes like, how do you prioritize the ideas and actually say which ones you're going to work on? But that's a better problem to have, I think, than actually not having good ideas come through.
Do you guys ever think of it almost like a parking lot? Like, I like that you said, not now, not at all. You're saying not now.
So
that's
interesting. Yeah, we have parking lots, but we call it backlogs, where, you know, we have this huge inventory of backlogs, and we're trying to say, okay, from a backlog, what would it take for it to get to be sort of in the works or in process? So we do a lot of lean management and lean way of doing things. And so one of the things about lean is, you know, you kind of monitor the flow of work and you have this backlog, and then you kind of move these cards through the process. So that's one way we think. But you'll see the backlog and there's some crazy ideas in there, which are, it's better to have those in the part than actually somebody self-filtering and not putting them in there.
So some of our biggest, you know, people always say, what are your failures? Timing. Sometimes ideas are too ahead of their time.
Yeah.
And it's funny, sometimes it's good to let it wait for a little while. Yeah. Maybe this is a great idea, but it needs a couple of years, and the company's got to catch up.
Right.
Do you ever see that? I mean, you guys have to have like all sorts of...
Yeah, we have, you know, I myself have a lot of ideas that probably were too early or too different or something like that. So we encourage it. We have this sort of hashtag of fast fail, where we show examples of ideas that, yeah, it was a good idea, but look, it was maybe not at the right time. It came from a different organization. You know, it was too expensive. You know, insurance is all about cost reduction. So sometimes the ideas, you just don't have the luxury of, you know, a Google or an Apple where you make, you know, a lot more money, right? Insurance, we, you know, our profit margins are like 4 cents to the dollar. So within that 4 cents, you have to figure out how you're going to do this. So we do have that bill where, you know, and some of us in leadership positions often present on things that we have tried and failed, and because it's not all about success, right? Because then it gives this idea that I need to have the right idea. And so I often talk about, you know, failures, because then people get more comfortable, to your point about like an idea, people are scared to bring it up, or a thought, bring it up, because they may fear it's like a bad idea or it may fail. And
some of the worst ideas lead to really good ideas.
Yeah.
Yeah, so question there. Just when you're picking up the microphone, just an academic comment on this. There's a significant amount of research which all show that at team level and team level innovation, I've done myself some of that on project teams and things like that, which show that knowledge diversity is one of the strongest predictors for radical innovation. So it's well known, established fact. And you many times are sort of at awe that
you still sort of don't understand. It's a relatively simple thing to understand. Of course, the challenge is that you need to have the right balance. If it's too diverse or too different, it gets harder. So you have to find the sweet spot. The other point which I want to say is that there's a lot of research also looking at knowledge depth. So if you have really deep specialists in certain fields, nearly all the effects are not that significant. The effects are nearly always negative. So if you have really deep knowledge in certain fields, it's actually not contributing to especially radical innovation, because these people are very invested in their knowledge. They're typically very narrow, and they cannot necessarily easily communicate. I'm not saying that not all people who have really deep in certain fields cannot do, but this is just across a large population.
My name is Jason Zeman. I'm a manager with Cohen & Company. Prior to my current role, I was at Deloitte, and prior to that, I was at Progressive as a data analyst, and have participated in multiple of the Edison challenges. So my favorite one was actually the recruiting one, how to recruit different analysts, which ties in almost directly to what you're talking about. And one point to add, as somebody that participated in the hackathons, we generally learn from somebody who is a peer or potentially a job grade below us, or multiple job grades below us to learn from. And the other piece of that too is, even with Edison, some of the bigger challenges too, you're learning from peers or people below you, or like Pat Callahan may comment and say, hey, great idea. Right. Walk me through what you're thinking about with this idea. So just one of the things to bring it down is where you both of your presentations, Bill and Pavan, tied in well together of it's breaking down that true hierarchy of a manager or director pushing something down and adding that in of work together as a team. And then sometimes they're acceptive of, hey, I'm not only just a peer of yours, I'm going to let you run with this, and I'm just going to be here to enable you.
I love that. It doesn't matter where the idea comes from, you know, but when you can get a talent, it's funny, all you need is that idea, but then when you get the team to rally around it, everybody can start to take ownership of it.
Right.
You know, people always can, when we work with companies, they're confused. They're like, how could there be six inventors on this patent?
Yeah.
Well, we don't think about it that way. It's really about the big picture. It's about producing something from it. And then all of a sudden, you're solving the problem for the customer. That's who really matters.
Right.
Right. It's got to be an experience. And then the team feels so fulfilled because something that they're part of turned into something. All these hours we're putting into it actually make use. That's pretty neat. I think the Edison Challenge sounds fascinating.
Yeah. It's been, very interesting. I ran that for a few years. Again, sometimes it's sort of the kernel of the idea, it's the seed of an idea that ends up somewhere else, and maybe the original person who put in the idea didn't actually mean it for this reason, A good example, I think Toyota had these Scion cars, and there was this one Scion that looks like a box car, I think, and they were made it for like surfers, but turns out a lot of like older people started using it because it was easy to get in and out of the car, and it's like, sometimes you come up with something, but it may get used for something else, like a battery sensor on your iPhone may detect temperature that's outside. And it's like these tangential things, you just have to kind of open your ears and be open to it. Like we have this thing called the usage-based insurance where you plug in a device into the car. It's supposed to measure, distance and speed and, things like that. But it also measures like voltage. And you can actually see if an alternator is going to fail because of some of the signals you get. We're not in that business, but it's an interesting sort of piece of data that you get. So looking at things that are, technologic variables, but demographic variables and ethnographic variables, they just sort of really kind of make all of this much more rich.
Yes, please.
This is by way of shameless self-promotion. Bill mentioned CES and it being really fertile territory. Case Western Reserve University has been at CES for the last 10 years, and actually we have the biggest. This is the shameless self-promotion
part.
We have the biggest presence of any university in the world, demonstrating our students' innovations and products and services. My question is about university and industry partnerships. You both mentioned it, and can you tell us, give us some examples of where they work the best and how they work the best?
The Bill? You want to? Well, first of all, I'd like to proudly say I will be exhibiting with Case this year in Eureka Park. I'm talking with Bob Sopko about that. I think what's exciting is this notion of tech transfer and the notion that we can help deliver it into the marketplace and work together. I think it has to be a mutual understanding of everybody wins. To his point, you may develop a technology that was supposed to be for this, but it might be more ideal for that when the consumer comes into the perspective. Be open to that. And then also, I always like this notion of, you know, most innovators are looking for the best solution, the best outcome. When good is pretty good, Gen 1 works. Save the good, the better, and the best for Gen 2 and Gen 3. But you got to get something in the marketplace to prove the ROI first. And the best way to do it is timing. Got to get it out there sooner than later. Because you have time to improve it and make it better, but you have to get it in the market first. I think the other thing, too, is the fact that Case Western has been such a big exhibitor at the CES really shows that they're trying to show the students what they can literally make, you know, to show that what you're putting in for this time for is going to turn into something and be on the global stage. So, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, the university partnerships is interesting. You know, I often, like, visually in my head, it's somewhat like this, you know, like there's just like a bridge that you're building from two sides, but they're just not quite meeting. And, you know, when you build it from one side, it's about, yeah, you have ideas and talent and, you know, you're teaching, it's academic, it's books, it's research, it's, you know, all this other stuff. And on this side, it's, you know, it's like profit margins and data privacy and intellectual property and all these things, you know. So when you try to build this bridge from two sides, sometimes you meet and sometimes you don't. And that gap is something, you know, like Anne Borchardt and I and Young Jin and I have been talking about, like, how do you bridge this gap? Because I think if you bridge the gap successfully, there's just amazing things can happen. But there's just this, sometimes it's a tricky proposition. So I'd rather folks who want to get into this university partnership think about some of these sort of unfun things to think about. Because if you can get those out of the way, I think you'll be much more successful. Because, like, you know, what can you patent? And what's intellectual property? What about the data? And, you know, if you anonymize the data, is it still useful? Like, all these things come up. And suddenly, you know, you're supposed to be, like, I don't know, at milepost 10, and you're stuck in, like, milepost 1 because you just couldn't get off the gate. So those are the things, if you have ways to tackle those and think through those and then let the work begin, I think that'll be successful.
Yeah, establishing that right relationship where, yeah, you know, it's not all or nothing. It can be a mutually beneficial opportunity, co-ownership of IP.
Right.
You know, I always say one of the hardest things about innovation is what I call inventor syndrome, where you think your idea is so amazing. Well, you have to be open to the ideas that you're not the customer.
Right.
You know, you have to allow it to evolve to what it needs to be. And that starts with, you know, the arrangement, right?
Yeah. One challenge there is typically that the inventor thinks that he or she knows best where it's going to be used.
Right.
Whereas, as you pointed out, most of the great innovations actually emerge from repurposing and finding the real use later. And it's user-driven, largely.
Right.
And so you have to listen very carefully what the users learn and how the users actually use that. So you have to have feedback channels, and you have to actually use that feedback for continuous innovation. That's the point which I wanted to make when I spoke about fluidity of the designs. You have to think that they are never fixed and permanent. There's always openness for something else until you may try it out at the later stages. But this is extremely important in digital products because they are very versatile, and you can change them relatively easily. So code is much more easier to change. It's brittle compared to hardware, mm-hmm, or physical products and manufacturing lines. Yes?
So question to you, as a part of Progressive, like we talked about different sessions, of the talent for digital transformation, how do you like manage in-house or outsource? What exactly?
In-house versus outsource, that's a good question. So I mean, historically, most of our talent has been in-house. We build all these facilities so we can actually have employees. And so historically, we have fewer sort of consultants kind of coming in and out. I know there are other companies that have a lot of sort of this higher proportion of consultants coming kind of in and out, Monday through Thursday kind of setup. We have actually much less of that, just because we kind of have a whole philosophy around employee engagement, culture, and we want sort of more of the one team approach. Having said that, I mean, there are areas where we just are not the experts, or we may not, it's not our core competency, building server farms or something like that, probably not a general core competency for us. And in those cases, we reach out to experts in the industry to come and help. So we sort of have now a bit more influx of maybe more external talent, partly because it may not be a core competency, partly because it may be such a niche competency that, we may not be the experts at it. We could take a stab at it, but may not be the best thing. So we often say, just because you can do it doesn't mean you should do it, and maybe if there's somebody else who can come in. But if we do have some of those arrangements, we always have an eye towards knowledge transfer, like how will this scale? If we have 10 consultants and we want to do it in now 5 more projects, are we going to have 50 consultants? Well, that's not going to work out. And so how do we bring it in-house? And so sort of think of it as, core competency versus not, niche competency versus not, and eventually with an eye towards bringing some of the talent in-house. I mean, there are other industries that have different ways of thinking. Fraud is a big component in insurance. And, sitting in Mayfield Village, sometimes you may not be able to think of all the kinds of fraud that can happen out there. So you find people who used to work at American Express and in New York City, and they have a whole different way they think about it. And you're like, we didn't think of it that way. Sometimes culturally, you know, when you tackle problems like that, you just don't, or you reach out to a company like H2O in California or Google or one of these companies, they think of everything as software problems. Like you bring any problem to them, they think of it as a software problem, as a coding problem. And we would normally say, let's get a staff of 10 people to solve something. They're like, you don't need that. You can just use machine learning and code to solve this problem. So in those cases, I think it's more important for us to reach out because we have this internal hubris, but we may or may, if it's working, that's fine. But more and more, we're learning that there's more talent pockets outside and we should bridge that. Because if we don't bridge it, one of our competitors is going to do it. And in an insurance space, it's really like competitor versus this competitor. It's, whoever's up ahead is the winner. So we are actively asking and seeking, going to conferences, listening to thoughts, spending time at other companies, like a mini sabbatical kind of thing, I think is a way to think about this.
Yeah, I think, outsourcing, I think, is a great way to test new things, something that is an adjacency.
Yeah.
I think, you're not taking it too serious, and then all of a sudden it could become a whole new division, right? So there could be some opportunities there.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
I'll just raise one additional point which relates to the idea of sort of how digital transformation changes the boundaries of firms. And one aspect which is really changing as a result of digital technologies is that the boundaries through which you actually generate the innovation itself. So, one of them is, of course, the consultancy and other ones. And what Bill talked about and actually also about P. Owen is the idea that you have to also build these relationships with the other ones as part of the sort of innovation process. And you cannot do it alone. But on top of that, there is currently a lot of work and also practice of crowdsourcing, real crowdsourcing. So you can, if you have well-defined, well-specified problems, which are parts of your innovation effort, you can crowdsource them. They can be software, they can be design, they can be making certain things and other ones, or just problems you don't know how to solve currently. And there are a lot of examples that innovative solutions may actually emerge from unusual places, unusual locations. And firms should probably much more think about in those terms. Of course, there are also crowdsourcing inside. And P. Owen offered examples of like Via Carras, that's basically it. But you can do it also outside the firm. So the boundaries are changing in that sense in multiple ways. And you have to think in a much broader terms that who is actually innovating for us? it's much broader space or type of people who can do it.
Yeah, I mean, the bottom line is you have to be open to yes. it in a way that, and it's hard. You know, I mean, humans, we have a resistance in some ways to some change, you know, and change is hard. And you know, I normally push a lot of change, and I feel like I'm somewhat okay with change until recently. You know, my fitness instructor was on vacation for a week, and I couldn't take the new fitness instructor. I was like, it's too much change. And it actually dawned on me that even I have some sort of adverse reaction to change. It's just in a different category, right? And so if you go to someone else, you know, they may have a different feeling about change. So change is hard. And I think it's better to realize that ahead of time and then work through it.
Yeah, I think I agree with you. It's easy to get comfortable. That's why sometimes it's good to be a viewer. You know, that's why I like going to exciting trade shows and see new demonstrations of things, mm-hmm. because sometimes step back and don't try to solve a problem you're having. Just see what other people are doing and just have a perspective, because then all of a sudden you start to look at these ideas and say, huh, that's interesting. It's not affecting what I'm doing right now, but it's something I can consider, right. You know, almost take the problem out of the situation.
That's a good point. You know? Yeah.
Yeah, I had a question. So I'm from Timken Corporation. My question is for actually Pawan and Bill as well. The question is around digital transformation, right? So as part of digital transformation, you have to fail and fail fast, right? So it applies in an agile world. I understand that I came from the agile world myself. And so how does that apply from a software perspective with regard to Progressive? And from a product perspective, with respect to Nottinghamsburg, so the product life cycles are different, and software life cycles are different. So, how do you fail and fail fast in a digital transformation world?
Yeah, you know, like Bill mentioned, you know, sometimes you just got to get it out there in front. It's truly about, for us, it's about getting it to the customer. You know, we have internal customers too, and we just, you know, have to set aside some funds. Or maybe we're not going to, you know, like if we track everything to the same level of profitability, then you may have a different, you know, you may not be able to succeed in some of those examples. So we're just actively trying to like set aside, you know, like venture fund or some sort of fund and say, okay, this pocket of dollars or resources, people and money, will be sort of measured differently than maybe the rest of the organization. And so that's a part of the Horizon strategy. That's one way to think about it. But even within Horizon One, you know, I know we've put things in front of our customers and they're like, oh, this is not gonna work, or you know, you just didn't get enough take rate, or it was too early maybe, or it was too different, things like that, you know. So we're big fans of just getting it out there. In an internet sort of world, it's much easier because you can put it out there and tomorrow take it down, and you know, it's sort of a few trees fell in the forest. Some people know about it, some people don't know about it, but that's fine, you know. We're very actively putting things in front of people and just get it out there. We have a usability lab where we actually invite real customers to come in, and we put it in front of them, and you know, with cameras, you've got eye tracking, all that other fun stuff happening, and then we see some things there, like initial reactions from people. But really, I think Steve Jobs said it, like, ship it is what he would say, is just ship it. And that's the only way to try some of these things.
Yeah, no, and it's funny, I'm seeing this really cool convergence between software testing and physical with augmented reality. Last week, I was at Magic Leap, and I'll tell you what, I got one of the Magic Leap ones, and we're going to start doing more augmented reality prototyping in full scale, where you don't have to even build it yet. You just want to see the size, see it. And then also, your concept of ship it, we have this concept of soft launch. You know, pick a target market, pick a retail partner, pick a certain region that is, so for example, we were launching a product with a food company, and we chose, of all things, Australia as mm-hmm. a launch partner, because they're similar consumers to the Americans, but it's a smaller market. and it's not American. So it's a way to test it there, to get some ideas, and then bring it here to a larger scale. So, you know, ship it, test it as fast as possible, because then you could change it. But you need to have data, you need to have feedback, or you're just working in a vacuum.
Yeah.
Right?
I think the other part in here is, you know, we have this notion of MVP, and so sometimes people immediately will be like, okay, I shipped the first part. But I think culturally, you need to be ready to get the feedback and ship the MVP number two, yeah, number three, and number four.
Get it ready to go.
If you just do number one and you're like, and then you're going to say, oh, I'm going to read it and then go back to waterfall or something like that, well, that's not going to work. If you're got to commit to, it's not, the first time around, I think everybody is very sort of excited about it, but you got to like figure out the third, fourth, fifth release. That's where I want to make sure the momentum is still there. And so on, because the first one generally is easy. Second, third, fourth, you know, people go, it's like a rubber band. If you stretch it for a while, it's okay, but then it goes back to its natural position. You cannot afford for that. So if you're going to get into this ship it mode, it's from there on, it's ship it, you know. There's like Google Chrome, I think they elevate every 6 weeks. There's just no option to that. Firefox is going to do every 4 weeks, I think, going forward. And there's a big blog post about how they're rethinking. But there is no undo here. They're not going to go back to like six-month releases. Once you say, I'm going to get out there, like even Office 365, I think, they've got monthly updates or whatever. Once you're out there, you know, the cat's out of the bag. You got to continue that.
I like your concept that you want to have the Gen 2, Gen 3, Gen 4 already in the works, because it gives you a chance to quickly adapt to some of these things. Yeah. But then also you're thinking about the bigger business mentality. Right. So a good idea will only thrive if there's a platform behind it, mm-hmm, that you're starting to build around.
And you don't want to distract the team with all of that stuff, so you need some other people kind of in the back, you know, like brooming behind people thinking about some of this stuff.
Yeah.
Because if the whole team starts thinking about Gen 4, then you'll never get Gen 1 out. But if no one's thinking about Gen 4, then you're going to crash and burn too. So you got to like balance that.
Be careful what you wish for. You're going to be an innovator.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes, that's true. Just one thing which I have also learned from this transformation to the digital form, especially given the fact that you can have now so much data about the products, the product use, and even during the process, the experimentation and all these other forms are actually forms of getting evidence to make more informed decisions. So for that academic scholar, this is pretty much like applying in a real-world setting experimental method, which we have been sort of training for the last 400 years since Galileo. And with my interactions with many of the people who are actually in this space, they say that one of the real benefits and also challenges in this related to talent is to actually to get the whole company to understand what is an experimental method, and how you really trust on the evidence. And it's not just that the person who is the highest paid who has the voice.
Yeah.
And just trust on the data and trust on that you make valid inferences from the data and evidence what you have. It changes the mentality in many places.
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah, we do a lot of A/B testing out, and so B or C or D, you know, like, and we give like 2% of the traffic, 3% of the traffic. Because, I mean, we have a Horizon 1 business. I mean, we have a regular day-to-day business too, right? And so while we want to transform, we can't hurt our existing business. And so we very, like, slowly kind of let it out, look at, and then measure B versus A or ABCD testing. So we do many of those. Lots of different test methodologies. Some tests take a longer time period to read. Like, if you put a TV ad out there, some of it is much more direct. You can read within days. Sometimes it takes much longer. Like policy life expectancy, you know, like if you do something and will this customer stay with us longer? Well, they're already staying with us years, so then you have to measure in years, and that's a different story than will they click on a blue button or a red button like today. So A/B testing is, and there's a lot more science to that, you know, but it's another way to kind of try some of these things.
We have still time, like 10 minutes, if there are other... Yes, please.
Tom Richter, Harbison Walker. I have two questions, actually. The first question is for Povan. In your video, you show quite prominently Andy Warhol's
yes.
Mao.
Yes.
Okay, so I can understand the connection between progressive and Andy Warhol, not that much about progressive and Mao, but the question is why Mao and not Marilyn Monroe?
That's a good question. So So one of the things we have is we have one of the largest art collections in the U.S. for any corporation, and Peter B. Lewis started it. His wife continues to sort of help with that. We have a whole curation office around buying art, and the whole point was, you know, don't just buy art and put it in a basement, put it out there. Right, and so we actually have Andy Warhol's Mao, and the thought there was it's actually in one of the most traversed hallways at Progressive, but part of it is also to be provocative to the point about like how do different ideas float and all of that. You know, we have a lot of provocative art to generate more ideas and generate more discussion. That I think. Some of that art used to be even in a conference room where it's like really in a tight space where you, even if you don't want to look, you may end up looking, you know what I mean? So, and what we encourage is when people become managers and they have offices, you know, this is back in the day when people would have offices, they could actually pick a piece of art and you would go down and look at all the art that is along the hallways or rooms and you'll say, I want this piece of art. And like, I have a piece of art that I no longer have an office, but I have it in one of the hallways that I traverse more often, and it's sort of this brain. It's actually a piece of fabric by Filomeno, it's a brain with a spinal cord, and like from the head there's like dandelions growing, and on the other side there's flowers growing, right? And so it's like, hey, there's just sometimes just junk, and then sometimes there's some good stuff. And that piece of art spoke to me, and people look at it, and I know it's got a fairly provocative title, but people read the title and they're like, wow, that's provocative. But the point I think that our art curators have is we're going to bring this sort of art and put it out there, right? And people read it. They, you know, some people have historical connections to those kind of art and they'll be like, wow. And then some people are new, you know, like some of the millennials may not know much about it and they'll read about it and learn. And often a lot of the art is used for directions. Hey, when you see Warhol, take a left turn. Office is right there. But it's like, wow, do you know? It's good. Like several, it's a very expensive piece of art. But that's, art is a part of...
Turn right at the Picasso.
Yeah, and that's actually on Progressive. It's a careers, it's on our website that we have, we're sort of put it out there.
So actually, that's original.
Yes. Yes.
That's interesting.
Yes. Okay. It's,
maybe yep. we should go and visit you. But the second question is actually more serious, and that it's about I would say the authority of the teams. I understand that the teamwork can be very, very efficient and very effective in getting you to the new accomplishments or new innovations and so on. But in an environment where you have old structures, how do you deal with the authority of the team for making the decisions, moving forward, getting the capital against the conflict which they inherently have to be effective in their normal performance, in their normal jobs? So, how do you assure that the team's moving fast forward, and how you can give them the responsibility and authority for decisions?
Yeah, a couple of different things. This is a very common topic, and you know, especially in this new transformation spaces, like who is the decision maker? It's sort of like everyone's looking around the room like, who is the decision maker here? And so I actually have a document that says, who is the decision maker? And it very clearly somewhat outlines how decisions will get made and what does the, like, to what level does the team have authority? And when we start projects or start a team, you know, we can tell them this is as far as they can go, and if they hit this point, they'll have to come talk to us, or they can go to the market and, you know, they'll have to have the pagers or whatever. So it's like different streams, but it's a good question, as in it's better to ask it up front versus when you're like halfway around the moon and you're like, okay, what are we doing next? Or who's going to give us the sort of the authority? With regards to funding, we have a fairly rigorous process where, you know, if you put a funding request for funding, there's a, like a cost-benefit analysis you have to put, and then we rank the projects. Like I said, you know, it's we have lots of ideas, only these many resources, and only this much time. So we sometimes we do have to say later for some things. But one other thing we have that's interesting is we have this thing called benefit realization. So when you actually put something in market, you can bring back and say, hey, this thing that we invested X dollars is resulting in Y benefit. That creates a very nice loop of saying, okay, well, we should do more of it and so on. So sort of a combination of things. Typically, the project managers and the business sponsors of the project have the full authority. And then they are sort of in that organization, then it'll be like a flat structure. So like I meet my team pretty much very frequently, and then they'll tell me, well, we're ready to go, we're not ready to go. You know, this project is green, this project is yellow, this project is red, help us. But it's more distributed authority than we think, because you have to kind of let people make decisions. Because if you're always the bottleneck, then that's not going to work. So we try to like break down the walls and just let people make decisions. And sometimes, you know, you learn it the hard way, and those are sometimes the best lessons to learn, actually. So it's a good question, and the best way to deal with it is to take on head on, like, hey, if this happens, what do we do? If that happens, who do we call? Who has the authority? Because, you know, you're dealing with real customers, you're dealing with real, you know, claims. And I mean, we're in sort of real world situations. Insurance is a very real world situation, right? It's a product that most people don't want to buy, and it's a product that most people don't want to use. Sort of the opposite of an iPhone, right? Like, you want to go to the Apple store, you want to buy this new 3-camera iPhone, and even before you leave the store, you want to rip open the box and use it. Our product is somewhat the opposite of that.
But when you have it and you need it, it
yes,
better work.
It better work, and that is sort of the moment of truth, right? That's the moment of truth is, will that 1-800-PROGRESSIVE answer your call? Will you be able to get through the systems? Will you get, you know, whatever the situation might be? So, but that's what we focus on, and we want to make sure that people have authority to do it.
I think that for both the products or services, whatever you produce, and also for the process, the teams which actually produce those things, for both of them, you probably need what I could call viable specification, minimal viable specification, in order for both of them to work. And I think the types of things which Paul pointed out are exactly that you have to have a certain minimal specification for the types of things which have to be settled in order for the team to work properly, like the product have to work properly. It may vary from context to context, and you have to be specific about it. Like more open and radical the innovation is, the probably less you need it. If you are very tight schedule and cost, you have much more specification which you have to constrain. So it depends. I'd actually raise one issue which we have been also looking at is the question of lesser time in teams and the question of playfulness. Because there's a lot of research, and we also did some research, that those teams which actually have little space to breathe, which have a possibility, which are playful about what they do, they don't actually focus on the thing, but they play around, are much more innovative. So how do you deal with that, and how do you balance that in the teams? Any comments or question on that?
Well, I do believe that sometimes when you give a team a large void, they'll fill it. And that's why it is important sometimes to be more efficient and, to your point, ship it. You know, sometimes you have to give the team enough time to make decisions, because if you almost give too much time, then they'll fill that void.
Right.
Right. I have an interesting analogy. My first job out of school was at General Motors, and I'm no longer there because there was this notion that it took 4 years to make a car. And I never understood why it took 4 years to make a car. Like, oh, don't worry, the first 3 years will go by like that. And it's like, well, they start with the premise it takes 4 years to make a car. Well, why don't we change that? You know, because you think about that, how do you compete with a Tesla coming out?
Yep.
Or, you know, and I think the notion is that you shouldn't create these these standard notions of time, because then they'll just fill that void, you know?
Yeah, you know, the playfulness, we encourage some of that through our Business Innovation Garage, where people can come and be playful and think differently. We have some of these hackathon events that allow people to think somewhat differently and try things in a very safe environment. And then team structure and just getting the team to actually, they have like bug hunts and things like that. Like they're being playful in their own space. So like if I find a bug in your code, I don't know, it's like a free lunch and like those kind of like bug hunt and kind of things. Just, again, these are things that it's not prescribed from anywhere else. I can tell you we probably have 100 different variations of plays going on right now, but it's better if the team sits down together and comes up with some playfulness concept, you know, and for them to play around with. I just saw a post last night on Instagram where there's a team that is, I don't know, they're playing a game amongst themselves because, you know, the stand-ups were getting too stressful or something like that. And somehow they ended up putting their stuff on Instagram, which is really cool because you can kind of say, wow, this they're putting this thing, you know, wait, what's on the, whatever that game is called. And it's kind of funny when you see that normally you would see a team standing in front of this board and doing like serious work, but they actually took a few minutes to just truly play and get to know each other. We do a lot of things like Myers-Briggs and DISC profiles and things like that. That's an important section because if you have different thought, you're not being difficult, you just have a different thought. And sometimes people have trouble separating those two. They'll be like, well, he's always being difficult. Well, it's not he's being difficult, he just has a different thought. And so when you do like a DISC assessment or a Myers-Briggs or something, they actually tell you who the person is, and that's just the way they think. And it's not that they're being like disruptive, they just, they are who they are and I am who I am. And so it's always good to know what your buildup is. And so we do, I think, many, several hundreds of DISC profiles are done weekly. And so people know their team, they know their, where they're coming from. And I think that's sort of important.
I think we are pretty much in time now. So I'd like to give a great applause to our panelists.
Thank you.